One important feature of the third edition of my book is the new content on what psychologists have been calling the replication crisis. In my view, the current debates are circling around at least three interconnected issues. The first is replication. Most of us have heard about the 2015 paper in which only 37% of a sample of 100 studies in psychology could be replicated. What happened? Is that 37% figure accurate? If it is only 37%, why did it happen and what does it mean? So that's the first issue. Many psychology studies have not replicated in direct replications. And the second issue is often called questionable research practices. That is, habits that scientists sometimes follow that they probably shouldn't. One example of a questionable research practice is harking, which stands for hypothesizing after the results are known. And this is when you wait for the results to come in and then write the introduction as if you predicted it all along. It's a questionable practice because surprise results may be especially likely to be flukes. They take advantage of chance variability in the data and they can't be replicated. Another questionable research practice is using very small sample sizes, either in the original study or in the replication study. And still another is p-hacking, making a series of choices such as eliminating outliers, looking for moderators, including, excluding covariates, and looking at the p-value each time and stopping when p finally falls below 0.05. When you p-hack, you take advantage of chance and you're more likely to end up with an unreproducible result. The third leg of the discussion is open science. This includes practices such as making peer-reviewed articles open access so that anybody can read them. Open science might include requiring researchers to publish their raw data so that others can independently analyze and confirm it. In chapter 14 of the book, I address all three of these elements and include a table depicting the different potential reasons for the lack of replication, including potential solutions that psychologists are now engaged in. For example, I write about the new practice of pre-registration, where psychologists publish their planned methods and hypotheses before collecting their data. This is an antidote to harking. Even some of the studies featured in my book have not stood up to replication. Some of these were in past editions, but are not included in the current one. If I heard about issues with studies in the third edition, I write about them on my Everyday Research Methods blog under a new section called Replication Updates. My own students have surprised me by their interest in this topic. In class, we talk about how the replication crisis has been difficult for psychologists, but has ultimately increased the scientific rigor of our field.